effect on me. Now, that clap was kind of beautiful for Harvard Med, but if you realize that you're here because God felt like you should be here, I want you to just take one step to the left and a little to the right and shake your neck. Just let it go a little bit. And then prepare, stretch your hands. We want to bring the clap from the insides of us because it may not feel like so, but the thing about Lazarus being in the grave was not necessarily that he was dead. He was just sleeping. And so it may not feel like much, but the thing about the seed is when the seed is put in the ground, it has to be put in a hole that was dug for it. And so you might be going through certain situations now, and it looks like other people set a trap for you. But that's okay. A seed does nothing wrong, but the ground is dug for it. It is put in the ground, and then it is covered with sand, and most times there is a stomping upon it. They put it in a dark place where the seed no longer can see its father and mother. So is there anybody here that in your time of waiting, you feel everybody has abandoned you? You realize that that's okay. That's the burying part. That's good. Are you still twisting and letting go? Because, yeah, I'm just trying to let you understand. And then the ground solidifies because when clay mixes with water, that's H2O, of course, the oxygen breaks down. And so the ground from the inside has to lose water. The lack of moisture causes the seed to rotten. It's in the decaying of the seed, the outer layer breaks for the inside to grow. Do you feel like the person that promised you, I'll be there throughout the worst? Do you feel like they are letting you go right now? That's okay. Just continue freeing your muscles because you're about to, you're not yet understanding. And in the absence of that, the farmer thinks he is doing this seed a favor by putting a stone over the sand so that the chicken doesn't come to scratch out and uproot the seed, without realizing that for you to come forth, you need to break through. But then again, I'm not worried because the river breaks through the rock. River is just water, but it's able to break through the rock in spite of the absence of congeality because for the singular reason that strength, it's not according to how fast we run, how strong we are. It's not about our will. But the water is able to break through the rock because of persistence. And for some reason, God looked at you and said, out of your belly shall flow rivers of living water. Are you ready to clap? Hold on. Hold on. And this seed is saying, this pastor has prophesied. Everybody is testifying. And it looked like I was breaking through. When I was being put in, all I saw was the sand. Realize that under you see the sand, but on the outside you do not see the stone. And it says the revealed things belong to us. The unrevealed belongs to him. And whilst you're binding and casting by the altar for the sand to be removed, he's busy waiting for you to ask for the stone to be rolled away. And so the seed waits a while. And one day, suddenly, the farmer remembers that it is time for this seed to break forth. And like news got to Jesus that Lazarus was sick, he could have run, he could have spoken a word, but he continued doing what he was doing. Because for Lazarus, there was no healing. There was only a resurrection available. And so like the prodigal son, don't worry, some of the things you hear are takeaway inspiration. When you get home, you will be able to understand it. So that's okay. We're just preparing to clap. Message has not begun. Just hold on. And for some reason, Jesus stayed put. And I'm wondering to myself, why is it that the prodigal son came back home and his father decides to kill a cow for him? And everybody preaches about the prodigal son. That's the bad one. But all of you here realize that we are Jesus' kids. And because we're Jesus' kids, we suffer more than the bad people. And someone said to me, just coming in, my aides were with me, complaining, why is it, Aunt Landa? She's a popular star, I know. She's saying, Aunt Landa, why is it with everything? Because we love God, it's hard. I said, that's okay, we're in devil's world. It's his world. They speak his language. They lie. They steal. They have to progress better than us. If you're progressing better than them, then you are in their world. I said to her, this is not my town. When I go back to West Palm Beach, Florida, you try to misbehave. Oh, I show you all shades of crazy because that's my home. But yeah, I have to apply decorum because I can be deported. And so right now we are in a foreign world. But realize, I want us to look at the son, the good son in the house. The Bible said he came and said to his father, I have been with you all this while and you have not even killed a goat for me. Now there's a problem with that. The father had no goats in his barn. He only had cows. And so the Christian child, the good child, was busy waiting for a mare when all his father had for him was a moo. And so as much as I love the introduction that she made, I want to correct that before the clap. She said something, it might not look like that. No. I want to make a U-turn. It has to look like that. I wish above all things that you will prosper and be in good health, even as your soul prospereth. So he doesn't have to be rude because he needs you to change. Because the truth is, you do not marry a big boy. We're church girls, we're queens, we marry kings. We're yet to clap, that's okay. And so I want you to just have the little understanding of what, as much as I understand that sweet and beautiful things come in wrappers. And so that's why they say you unwrap it. You need to realize something, that when you enter a store where gold is put, it doesn't whistle at you. It sits still under the bright light, and you check your wallet, and you go to get the funds for it. It doesn't beg you. You beg it for a discount. And that being said, no matter what is happening in your situation, do not let the situational conditioning of your present economical state make you forget you're a king. Because the moment the king walks away from his throne to say hello to something that looks like a queen but not a queen, he forgets his authority. And without an authority, you're just a big boy on a big chair. No glory, no kingship. And so, they may be in the church or outside the church, but there's something about God in the seed. No matter how long the stone is in there, when the stone is rolled away, the doctor in me always makes me wonder, how come there was no muscle atrophy? The stone was rolled away, and he did not say, Lazarus, come forth. Lazarus, what happened was, the moment Lazarus died, his coming forth became a position of kingship. When he died, he needed Jesus. He did everything. But this time at the resurrection, the Bible said, Jesus said to them, take the ropes away. People who buried him, it took just four days. It's like they were expecting him to die. In 4 days, they had done all the rituals. They had even put a stone. I know a lot of people are waiting for you to die so they can bury you. And a lot of people waiting for you to go back without a relationship, but that's okay. Thing about relationship is, after a period of time, you realize that he that findeth a wife finds a good thing. And so once you become a good thing, you do not bother with the searching. You're about to clap now, because when the seed chooses to germinate, if you look at the bird of any seed, it starts from the center, not on the outside. No matter how dirty a car is on the outside, the power does not lie on the outside. It lies on the unseen engine on the inside. And so it could have a tattered body and the tires may not work. But if the engine can rev, even the alloy will roll. And so you might not look like much right now, but when it is you, it is you. And so if you can feel that the God who put your engine on the inside is here, I want you to clap like you mean it. Aha! Those things we were supposed to talk about, I need them up here, because over the next few minutes we're going to be addressing them. Can I have them, please? I tell people, how many people here listen to the show, Sharing Life Issues? Oh, okay, so I have customers here. Aha, yeah. There's something valid I say to people. I was brought up by a queen, and so I do not speak much about kings as much as I speak about queens. And if I was a man, maybe I would understand what it means to be a man. Of course, I have my PhD in clinical and relational psychology, so I can say to you all of the biological sensitivities of what it means to be a man, or the neuroscience of what it means to have an ego. But what I know is this much, that a king is supposed to be the head. And if you're a chess player by me, you know that the king's movements are very few. He moves this way, he moves back. He moves this way, he moves back. He moves this way, he moves back. But he has a queen who moves that way, that way, that way. And no matter how incessant and spontaneous the queen is, it does not shift the king from his position. The ravings of the queen could show, but the moment the king dies, the game is over. And so as much as a lot of people want to be feminists, and kudos to you guys, I respect all of those. I am one of those people who worships my husband. I call him Lord because he is my king here. And that being said, I know a lot of people would not like that, but over the period of time, we're going to start with the first things first, which is supposed to be the man and his woman. We'll be taking a lot of questions, and so I hope the ushers are helping me passing around papers for anonymous questions, and I'll be going in. I want to start by introducing myself first, and that way we will continue. My name is Dr. Yolanda Enja David, originally born as Eagle Judge David. My father looked at me because I was supposed to be a stillbirth, and he came to the hospital, held on to this dead child, and for some reason, she breathed again. And because he felt that no matter how weak the eagle gets, the eagle goes to the mountain, renews her strength, and comes back, he chose to call me the eagle. And so after a while, my mom, Yolanda Senior, who is also a doctor, a child psychologist, decided, everybody, you mean the bed? Her name is the bed? Eagle, the bed? And so over time, I became Yolanda Junior, like my mother was, Senior. And Yolanda George had grown through a lot of things, but there's one thing, my life was one unexpected. Went to the St. John's School for Special Kids, and so by 12, I was in pre-med. By 13, I was in Harvard Medical School. By 13 and some months further, I was reading medicine in Harvard Medical School, but I had begun my training also, a second first degree in software engineering, University of Pittsburgh. And so by 18, I was first a doctor, and then a few weeks later, I was a software engineer. Now I'm giving you a lot of background because a lot of women will listen to me and go and say, there's a valid question I got from one of our posts. We posted this on one of our pages, counseling pages, and a lady said, what is it about Antlander saying a man and his woman? It should be a man and a woman. And I want you, the discussion just went into who is better than who, and one pastor, one female pastor wanted to try to prove a point and started talking to me how she cannot achieve everything she had achieved and now give everything to the man. That being said, I realized that a lot of people do not understand the basis of it. So let me finish my introduction, because by the time we leave here, some of you will need to take paracetamol because you will be getting some truth pounded into your system. Social media has created a falsified version of the essence of marriage, love, and happiness. And in the place of cyber reality, you have the option of editing or filtering and actually contouring places that were not as though they were. But in reality, happiness is not about the smile. The truth is, your happiest moments can never be captured on a camera because you cannot pause to wait to take a selfie when you're truly happy. The tastiest of foods you will ever eat are the ones that after you have finished and you're about to wash the pot, your finger scrapes the bottom and you taste something and it goes, ayaya, that is not on Instagram, but that is the tastiest of food. You could put all of the greens and the orange and put all of the filter to make it look shiny, but if it is not the burnt bottom pot of some old pot that is bad, it doesn't taste as good as it looks. And so I'll continue. United Nations took the best three in my class. I was the second grad, best graduating student in my class with our GPA in Harvard Med. Until tomorrow, my father says I failed because I failed with a 0.00001. And I'm giving you that as an idea to know the kind of preparation I had in life. I failed because, of course, it was the clinicals, and you know that in your final MB, you have to see a full cadaver. And all through med school, I had been fortunate to be given female cadavers, but because I was a Christian child, the first time I see a naked guy for real on my tab, I pass out, hence my 0.111. And so I finished second and I became a United Nations ambassador. I went straight to Johns Hopkins and I began my residency, OBGYN, obstetrics and gynecology. And I went from there to Queen Elizabeth Hospital in the UK and I did my PhD at the age of 21, female fertility medicine. No, hold on, it's coming. Yeah, now you love me. I've not yet started attacking, so maybe you should clap. Yeah, that's okay, because I'll miss that later. And going through the works, people said to me, was it that you did not want to date anybody? I said to them, no, I was my parents' prayer point. It wasn't an absence of men, it was just a presence of vision. I wasn't lacking anything I could not get. And so I did not feel the need to be like other people in my school. Understand, at age 13, in Nigeria, Africa is weird. But back home, there were some people who actually got their PhDs even at that 13. So I was not really, really a star back home in the US. And so it was a struggle to keep my grades up. And I had a father who was a PhD economics and a general at that. And a mother clinical psychology who was always psychoanalyzing your every mood. Before you did PAM, she was ahead of you. And I went through the phase of wanting to know, because I went to St. John's School for Special Kids. That's the school where they send all the kids who they feel have a higher IQ and they want to get the best out of you. And so I wanted to understand what God was. In there, I met a friend called Rahim. And Rahim was trying to convince me that Islam was, it was the religion to go. And my mom was the woman who dressed the altar all her life. And my father was the guy who, he's a general on the outside, but when Bishop wanted to preach, he carried the Bishop's Bible. And so his staff waited on the outside whilst he served. And later, when his schedule became so busy, he became head chief sanitation officer. And it just was messing with my head. And so over the years, I remember quoting the Quran on radio some time ago, and a lot of people went on social media to say, how did you know the Quran? Da, 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 da. And the thing is, from my experience, I wanted to know I was a child of God, not because my parents were, but because I knew who God was. So by the time I turned 26, I had gotten my master's in Islamic studies and my PhD in theology and demonology. I had gotten a first degree in Hinduism, and I wanted to understand what it meant to be a Judaist, so I got an advanced diploma in that. Now the thing is, you need to know your enemy before you go to war. And so all through this time, I was gathering all of those degrees. Of course, I didn't stop reading. Before I turned, let's just say before I was 27, there was the PhD in software engineering, working with Microsoft. I started my foundation at Landers Bethel Foundation at 16. And so because I was not yet 18, my parents had to be registered with it in the US. And so my mother had to stand for me to adopt the first kids, and I'll pick the prostitutes and bring to the house. And my mother, after a while, started saying, okay, can't you try to be a bad girl a little? Can't you try to misbehave a little? Must you always be picking prostitutes? You're 16, you're 17. And this was something I had done. Is there any girl going through a process of building your empire and people saying to you, because you have a car, because you have a house, because you have a dream, that's why you do not have a man? Now understand that wealth does not equal pride. And achievement does not mean the absence of humility. The Bible says, he that finds a wife finds a good thing. Problem a lot of men have is we are having plenty things, but they are not good enough to be good things. Now, no clap. Nobody will like me so much. Come again. We're having a lot of big girls who need body magic to give them a certain figure eight that they cannot bend or fold. When they're walking this way. And they cannot smile because they are not comfortable with what they wear. And of course, they cannot even breathe. So when a boy says you're looking beautiful, it's not that she doesn't like what you're saying. But how does she choose between breathing and smiling? So she would rather not smile to survive. And we have become so manicured as human beings that we have forgotten the essence of humanity. It is in our flaws that our personalities are founded. It's in our inadequacies that we need each other to survive. And it is in the fear of being a woman, the man finds his woman. Point number one, the man and his woman. In the beginning, God created heaven and earth and all of those beautiful yada, yada, yada. He created man and took his time to create woman. But there was essence in the point that the man trusted the woman enough to eat the apple off her. And when you watch the punishments, the man got more than the woman did. People say labor, but you see, any woman now is talking about labor, I'll just spank you from the behind. There's epidural, there's all of that. You go there with makeup right now to push. Your pictures are on Instagram. But no matter how much science advances, the ground gets harder as life gets easier for the woman, because the crime and the punishment was, in all fairness, on the man. The man failed God. God asked for the man when he returned. God had no business with the woman. God had a dealing with the man. Because the woman is nothing without the man, but the man was something without the woman. Is anybody in church today? There was an Adam without the Eve, but there was no Eve without the Adam. And so because we have broken our man, thank you so much. Because we have broken our men so much so, we say they are African men, so they should be strong. And when they are strong, we say they don't have an emotional side, so they should cry. And when they cry, we say they are too weak, so they should be defensive. And when they defend us, we say they are being overprotective. And when they step back, we say they do not care. And when they provide for us, we say to them, you don't want us to make our own money. And when they don't provide for us, we say to them, even the Bible says that a man should provide for his own household. And in this battle of this generation, no man is good enough. Hence the word, the man and his woman. They say behind every successful man is a woman. And anybody can say anything, but I know that the car would not move without the steering behind it. And most importantly, the steering would not be able to move without the driver behind it. And so we have groomed a generation of women who think they deserve to be accommodated, that they do not invest in becoming that good thing. All of the single women in the midst of this communique will stand up. But until then, right now I want to tell you something. Over the course of this year, I have spoken at a lot of events like it is my way to do. And one thing always stands right. Every girl knows the kind of man that she wants. He should be God-fearing. He should be this. He should be that. But who are you? The question I always ask people, even back at my home station, Inspiration FM, to some of the OAPs, it's not about calling and matchmaking anybody. Because no matter how good a man is, you pair him up with a bad propeller at the back and he's just going to sink. You can ask any boat. The quality of the ship is nothing if its propellers are bad. And so as much as I am not holding brief for the men, and men, don't be too comfortable. When I come to you, you try to fly off the windows. But for now, let's talk to the women. There was a point in the Bible that spoke about the waiting game, and I like using that when it comes to waiting on God. And it's not about marriage, but the thing about waiting on God is it takes you through a lot of motions. I never prayed or waited for a husband. Hence the interview my husband gave when God chose that I actually have a husband, and he got to my father. My father showed him that he was number 97. And he took a picture. My father is crazy like I'm crazy. And so he took the picture, put him, gave him number 97, said, now go, all of you come to me, go and convince the girl herself that you want to get married. Now, I never waited on God for that. But then again, I did wait on God for my son. I went through 18 miscarriages as an OBGYN. 18 miscarriages. Positive tests, then miscarriages. 18 before I got my son, Jaron. And that's why my son is just 3 years old. And when you look at the waiting game, the tendencies were, people might have assumed all of that was because of something I had done wrong in my past, or something that my husband had done wrong in their past. But because I was a virgin even before I got married, and on my wedding night, I was called for a rape case, so I had to go rescue a rapist. So on my wedding night, I was still a virgin. Nobody could convince me that God was punishing me for something. So through my weight, the devil did not have my mind. But right now, 90% of you waiting on God for something, you are judging and believing the lies of the enemy based on the workings and the mistakes of your past. And so even when a brother says to you, "I love you," you do not believe him because 11 other guys said, "I loved you," and they broke your heart. And so when I said the man and his woman, I mean that any man that says "I do" to a woman is, unfortunately, in my generation, marrying the woman and all of her exes, all of her pain, all of her bitterness. And if he brings popcorn and says, "Let us talk," and her fourth boyfriend broke up with her after he brought popcorn, before he begins to talk, she shouts because she will say, "I have seen this before." And so the man and his woman. Point number two, please. The dating game, according to psychology, it takes 0.006 seconds for you to fall in love. And I wouldn't say something about falling in love, because somewhere down we'll talk about that. Now, I could bring two total strangers together, and under hypnosis, they will be head over heels with each other, because the feeling, the intense feeling, the overwhelming feeling that you feel when you see someone and you like the person, the reason why everything becomes beautiful, you like the way the person brushes his teeth, the way he walks, and everything he does, is very simple. And that's the point. It's so simple because it's all in the neuroscience of it. Somewhere at you, in your brain, I was told by my PA today to try not to use my medical terms, so I am working hard on that, so bear with me. But somewhere in the front of your head, the frontal lobe, yes, I'm trying. Somewhere here, there is a part of your brain, the name I wouldn't mention so you don't get scared, that releases something called the serotonin, oxytocin, and most important, sorry, I couldn't do without that, most importantly, the dopamine. Now, when he touches you, for a reason, when he touches you, what you feel is the warmth of oxytocin go through your body. "Oh, he touched me and I felt the goose pimple." You see, that thing that makes you shiver, that you actually feel like there's a cold going through your bones at that point in time, exactly. It's not you falling in love. It is chemistry. God just put a lot of chemicals. It's just like a lab and something poured over. The lifespan of oxytocin in your system is 6 weeks. That's why after you meet a guy, after 6 weeks, he's no more all that. Is anybody in church today? And so for 6 weeks, you're doing midnight call. The sleep doesn't appear after 6 weeks. It's one guy I met like that. Now, if you are the kind of guy who is fortunate, because we need to go to the third one, the wedding party. If you're the kind of guy that does not work with the workings of God, and you do not do what God wants you to do, and you choose for some reason to just stay, at the point where you see the girl, you like the girl, and you choose to do the nasty. Let's call it the nasty because we're in church and I don't want pastor to start speaking in tongues. And so you get to do the nasty. And when you do the nasty, what happens is, oxytocin is called the cuddle hormone for a reason. The nasty. He nearly said rum boom. The nasty releases not just oxytocin. It comes with a backup of dopamine, which is the feel-good hormone. And so the feel-good hormone is the reason why after you do the nasty, you just want to sleep and you talk rubbish. Ask a guy to sign a check of $10 billion. He's going to sign it even though he knows his whole generation, when you sell, no $10 billion coming out, love. And so for some reason, when you get that release, you want to do anything for that person. Now, unfortunately, for the man, he gets more dopamine than he gets oxytocin because he has testosterone in his system. And so the testosterone he constantly releases makes it impossible for oxytocin to actually last that long. That's why the lame people say men are visual. No, they are not visual. It's just that they run out of oxytocin so fast that they need to see something else. It's the hunger and want for the repetition of that which happened before that actually gets them aroused again. And so what happens is the nasty has two different effects on two different people. You know the reason why? I know some married people are here, I hope. Okay. You see the reason why auntie is always having headache now? Every time you want to do the do. And no paracetamol will cure that headache except she is ready to do the do. It's because the nasty for the man triggers the want for more nasty. But for the woman, after every episode, she actually gets an excess supply. And if she's of a very fertile age, this is what happens. Unfortunately, there's no blackboard. So this is what happens. She gets the release of oxytocin, and she gets the release of dopamine. The feel-good hormone is not enough to make her feel good. So she convinces herself that the guy who did the nasty with her is in love with her. And so all the women who say he said he loved me and he broke up with me, when we sit down in counseling, in all fairness, he never really said, I love you. She actually felt the way he held her, he looked at her, and whatever was said in the midst of all of the nasty was valid. And so the guy thinks that he went for a takeout. You know when you go to a buffet, they say, eat as you want. And he's moving to another place. And that action makes the guy want more. And the action makes the woman want less. Because she has felt the cuddle. She is creating a warmth in her subconscious. And the same way men are not able to remember your birthday, but they can remember who is playing what match at what time, because of the way their memories are fouled. Their memories are fouled based on the release of adrenaline and oxytocin at that point. But the woman is able to remember that you were wearing a blue shirt on top of green on that day that the fan turned to the left small. And you said that I should go to that place. I said I will not go, but you called your mother and your mother picked the call and said, eh? And that was 1963. I think it was the 4th of February. And now you are pretending, as God is my witness. Was it not how you were holding that handkerchief there? The reason the women remember all those details, but they never remember the hurtful things they say to you, is because the woman's brain is wired to remember only things that benefit her. That is why she goes through labor pain and still wants to get pregnant again. If her brain was wired in another way, thank not for neuroscience, I'm not preaching right now. If not for neuroscience, after the discomfort of the first pregnancy, the woman will never go again. So aversion therapy works with men. If a man goes to a place and he feels a little discomfort in his local government area, let's call that, he will never do that thing again. But no matter how hard it hurts a woman, she would not remember it because her brain was not wired. The way her brain was wired, according to neuroscience, is for her to remember only the things that benefit her. So if you give her checks every day, you're going to be the love of her life. Because the check's clear and it benefits her. Is anybody in church? Can we continue, please? The wedding party, the ashoibi. The problem is that the wedding is more extravagant than the planning of the marriage. The wedding is a confluence of all of the possibilities of showing up to all the people that thought you could never achieve what you have achieved. And so the wedding is not about the vow, as sad as it is. The marriage is about the vow. The wedding is about proving. You said I can't marry Abby. My gown from here to Kafanchan. Now, when a man is in need for more, and he cannot get more because he is getting to that age where he needs to marry. I laugh at all of the pictures that they put. You know, a lot of singles refuse to accept the proposal because the proposal does not look like what was on Instagram. And I say this thing every time, they don't understand. It is impossible for you to propose to a lady with all of this AC around here. Are you seeing how I'm sweating? Tell me how possible it is. On Instagram, the guy just goes into a room where they were having dinner. He says, "Will you marry me?" Suddenly, her eyelashes are fixed. Her nails are well done. She has had the best dress. They just went on a regular dinner. "Oh, we just closed work." And he stopped by the road and knelt down in front of the damfo. "Will you marry me?" And no conductor said, "Leave the place, I'm in danger." You live in a highly directed, dramatized world. And so if you try to compete with the staged, you have to have the script. If you are without the script, then you need the Bible. Either way, you need something written for you. And so if there is someone here who wants their relationship to work, it's either you are sad and you pretend you are happy. That is the scripted version. Or you go to the Bible and says, "For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and cleave to his wife, and the two will become one." And women use that as a weapon of warfare to torture their husbands. But what you do not realize is anybody that enters my counseling room that uses that as a woman, you have just set yourself up for trouble. The man shall leave his mother and father. God never had an issue with tenses. He did not say a man would forsake. When he wanted us to leave our evil ways, he said, "If any man be in Christ," Old King James Version, "and forsakes his old ways." The Bible never said that. He said, "A man will leave. I am leaving the altar and I am entering the crowd. I am not banned from going back to the altar." The man will leave his mother and father
and cleave to his wife. The act of cleaving in those days was one of a tree being attached to another tree so that it can uphold it during the winter time because of the release and the sharing of moisture that happened. Understand that even in winter, the Bible was set in the place of Judah where we realized it was really, really sandy. It was filled with desert. So cleaving is not an abandonment to take up your problems. Cleaving is walking away a certain part of you and holding on to another person for support, not for draining. In other words, the fact that he said he loved you does not mean he decided to pay your mother's house rent. If he had not married you, your mother wouldn't have been homeless. Deal with it. Now I'm in the crowd so that if you want to eye me, I want to see your anger face to face. The whole idea about relationship, we have gotten it so messed up, and that's the reason why nobody really wants to be married, in all fairness. We have more unhappily married people than we have happily married people. A woman who had been married, a pastor I've been preaching in their church every time I go to Australia, had said to me, when I went for their 30th anniversary, and she said to me, at that time when I went for that anniversary, their marriage was older than me in existence. And she said to me, the last time I was happy was the day of my wedding. But she has this big ministry where everybody who is broken goes to. And she had the right words. And they had a relationship that worked, but it was a commitment that was working. It was not a love affair. Now, the neuroscience of it is simple. When you fall in love, you make the mistake. You do not realize, like your human body, love grows. It's impossible for a man to love his wife as though he was dating the wife. Because at the first introduction of the relationship, the first 6 weeks is where you have the highest peak of all of the romantic essences of it. And so every time you see a woman on social media saying, oh, my husband did this, he just cooked for me, and oh, listen, she's missing the days he used to care for her, so she's projecting unhappiness. So when people say we're happy for you, she feels validated. Because a woman who truly just had breakfast in bed will not see the need for outsiders to share in that kind of happiness. And the problem with that is real people who are struggling to find a way to make their love work are competing with the fake projections of people on social media. So the man has a busy day. He's stuck in traffic. He does counseling if he's a pastor, or he sees patients if he's a surgeon. And he's about to get home, and he does a text message to you and says, I'm coming home. And you say, since morning you left the house, you could not text me. You could not ask me how I was doing. And now you're coming home, you're asking me. And the next 2 days, he doesn't text you that he's coming home. And you say, you don't love me alone. And the truth is simple. When he tried to reach out, you shut the door. And until you realize that love metamorphosizes from being as erotic, eros, as it should be, to becoming philia, which is that of a sibling. If a man truly loves his wife, arousal is biologically impossible. Without any kind of enticement. Is anybody hearing me? Married men do not develop low sperm counts or erection issues because they are married. They just cannot do the do because they are not enticed enough by their wives. Because the moment he falls in love with you, he stops wanting to have you like he's going to lose you. And that is the song that should be sung for people who really know they are moving away. He wants to protect you. And that act is too dirty. He sees you as his own. And somewhere in his brain, it cannot click for him to see you and want you. And so the church tells us to speak in tongues and pray. But the truth is, if you want your husband to want you, you need to show him and make him need you. Remember how you used to dress when you were going on the date? And used to change 6, 7, 8 dresses to accentuate all of your best figures and hide all of your flaws when you used to date. The moment you get married and you have a baby, and every time he comes back, he meets a masquerade that has put pimple cream on her face, tied a headgear, and has a dress that can be used to cover that canopy. And you say, "Honey, welcome. How are you? Your food is there. Should I wait for you in the bedroom?" And he says, "Don't worry, sleep." And you are upset. Could we move on to the list, please? The Mr. and his Mrs. That's where we are on right now. But right under that is sex. Oh, sorry, nasty, man of God. And the absence of it. Okay, so we're okay, right? Okay, yeah. I just feel like Elisha after Elijah dropped the mantle on him. Ah. Pastor said, "Dr. Elanda, be naughty." Okay, let's go. Okay, so I should not be nothing. Okay, don't worry. Okay, let's keep some in our pocket because we are putting it on social media. I will try. The thing about the absence of sex. Yeah, why are you laughing? In the house, especially when it comes with marriage, is the fact that we take for granted the essence and the physicality of it. Women think it is their right to be chased, pursued, and wooed. And because of that, they lie like log of wood and expect the guy who broke his back in the office to break his back in the bedroom. As his age increases and the numbers of his candles increase on his cake, so does the ache in his back and in his waist increase. And as much as we avoid this very valid issue, the fact that your husband is not sleeping with you does not mean he doesn't love you. The fact that your wife isn't sleeping with you does not mean that she doesn't love you. Even more important is the fact that there's an absence of the nasty does not mean that there is an absence of love or that he or she is cheating on you. The accusation of a third party in a relationship is the only reason a lot of married people are in emotional relationships that might grow into sexual affairs if the wives do not continue pushing them out. And the reason why I did not write emotional cheating on that list is because As a psychologist, I encourage a lot of women, and a lot of people argue that with me. I encourage a lot of women to let their husbands chat with anybody they want to chat with. Anybody. Because in all fairness, a man who loves his wife is too proud to lick his lips and smile and respond to a woman in public like he would do, which is a biological trigger. So he goes to text messaging and he replies, "Thank you." She says, "Oh, you looked so good today." And he boosts his ego. And sometimes it reminds him of who he used to be. And he comes home to you. The moment you accuse him and he feels the need to confide in her, it grows from a discussion of emotional support to an emotional affair where he cannot live without that woman. Because the definition of an emotional affair is not what a lot of counselors define. For some reason, I worry because we have a lot of uneducated counselors. Emotional affairs are only affairs where you get your sexual and sexual arousals suited by the emotional exchange behind the screen. Do you understand? So you could actually have a pseudo friend that reminds you of what your wife used to be, and she gets you to go home to her. You could have a man who says to you, "You can do better than this," or praises you like your husband used to do before he became swamped, and he wants you, and he does certain things that, you know, my husband will never.